Wild Child. 1. During the first hard rain of autumn, when the leaves lay like currency at the feet of the trees and the branches shone black against the diminished sky, a party of hunters from the village of Lacaune in the Languedoc region of France, returning cold and damp and without anything tangible to show for their efforts, spotted a human figure in the gloom ahead. The figure appeared to be that of a child, a boy, and he was entirely naked, indifferent to the cold and the rain. He was preoccupied with something, cracking acorns between two rocks, as it turned out, and didn't at first see them coming. But then one of the party, Messier, the village smith, whose hands and forearms had been rendered the color of a red Indian's with the hard use of his trade, stepped in a hole and lost his balance, lurching into the boy's field of vision. It was that sudden movement that spooked him. One moment he was there, crouched over his store of raw acorns, and the next he was gone, vanishing into the undergrowth with the hypersensitivity of a stoat or weasel. None of them could be sure the encounter had been so brief a matter of seconds, but they unanimously claimed that the figure had fled on all fours. A week later, the boy was spotted again, this time at the verge of a farmer's field, digging potatoes from the ground and bolting them as they were without benefit of cooking or even rinsing. The farmer's instinct was to chase him off, but he restrained himself. He'd heard the reports of a wild child, a child of the forest, an enfant sauvage, and he crept closer to better observe the phenomenon before him. He saw that the child was very young indeed, 8 or 9 years old, if that, and that he used only his bare hands and broken nails to dig in the sodden earth like a dog. To all outward appearances, the child seemed normal, having the fluid use of his limbs and hands. But his emaciation was alarming, and his movements were swift and autonomous. At some point, after the farmer had approached to within 20 yards of him, the child reared his head and made eye contact. It was difficult to see the child's face because of the unbarbered thatch of his hair and the way it masked his features. Nothing moved, not the flock on the hill, nor the clouds in the sky. The countryside seemed preternaturally silent, the birds in the hedgerows holding their breath, the wind stilled, the very insects mute underfoot. That look, the unblinking eyes, black as coffee poured straight from the pot, the tightening of the mouth around discolored canines, was the look of a thing out of Spiritus Mundi, deranged, alien, hateful. It was the farmer who had to turn away. That was how it began, the legend brewing, stewing, simmering in every pot throughout the district through the fall of 1797, in the 5th year of the new French Republic, and into the year that succeeded it. The terror was over. The king was dead. Life, especially in the provinces, returning to normal. People needed a mystery to sustain them, a belief in the arcane and the miraculous, and any number of them, mushroom gatherers and truffle diggers, squirrel hunters, peasants bent under the weight of faggots or baskets of turnips and onions, kept watch in the woods. But it wasn't until the following spring that the boy was sighted again, this time by a party of 3 woodcutters, led by Messier the smith, and this time they gave chase. They chased the boy without thinking, without reason. Chased him because he ran from them, and they might have been chasing anything, a cat, a hind, a boar. Eventually, they ran him to tree, where he hissed and flailed the branches, flinging things down on them. Each time one of them attempted to mount into the branches and snatch for the boy's calloused foot, he was pummeled and bitten, until finally they decided to smoke him out. A fire was built beneath the tree, the boy all the while watching these 3 bipeds, these shagged and violent and strangely habited and gibbering animals, out of the deep retreat of his eyes. Picture him there, crouched in the highest branches, his skin so nicked and abraded it was like hide haphazardly tanned, the scar at his throat a bleached white tear visible even from the ground, his feet dangling, arms limp, as the smoke rose about him. Picture him, because he wasn't able to picture himself. He knew nothing but the immediate, felt only what his senses transmitted to him. When he was a child of 5, small and undernourished, the stubborn 13th child of a stubborn peasant family, his mind lax and prelingual, he was taken out into the forest of La Bassine by a woman he hardly knew or acknowledged, his father's 2nd wife. And she didn't have the strength to do what she had to do. And so, when she took him by the hair and twisted his head to expose the taut flesh of his throat, she shut her eyes fast, and the kitchen knife missed its stroke. Still, it was enough. His blood drew steam from the leaves, and he lay there in a shrunken skeletal nest, night coming down and the woman already receding into the trees. He had no memory of any of it.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.